오늘 광화문 초대석은 일리아 폴로스킨 리어 프로토콜 창업자를 모셨습니다. Hi,
Hi.
thank you for coming. Can you tell us your journey into the blockchain?
I've been interested in machine learning and AI since I was, I don't know, 11. And so I've been kind of playing around programming some neural networks when I was 14, 15. And I started working for a machine learning company when I was 17 while I was in university. And I ended up moving to US to work for that company and then joining Google Research to as I saw deep learning to becoming kind of an important wave. At Google, I worked across natural language understanding, question answering, and ended up co-authoring Attention's All You Need paper. And I really believe that we're going to see a massive transition when this AI models will allow everyone to build their own software. And so we actually started a Near AI originally as an AI company where we were teaching machines to code. So now this was 2017. These models were just coming out. There was not enough kind of compute yet to train them at scale. We also were like a new startup that didn't have capacity to do that yet. And so we ended up trying to work with a lot more students around the world to actually get better training data. And we faced this challenge that paying people around the world is actually pretty hard. And it was complex between different countries, students didn't have bank accounts. And we started looking at blockchain as a way to solve our own problem. We wanted to have programmable payments and a way to pretty much coordinate resources around the world. And looking into this, the realization was there's nothing that actually solves the problem in a way that is scalable, meaning offers, cheap fees, like cheaper than Web2 fees, and offers a way to do this really easy for the user. So kind of abstracting the complexity of the blockchain. And so Near Protocol started this idea that we want to offer a platform that can scale to 1 billion users without increasing prices and ease of use for developers and users such that they don't even need to think about the blockchain as much as possible. And so that was in 2018 and been a very interesting journey ever since.
Nice. Because you mentioned your paper, Attention is All You Need. So I wonder how this paper contributed to the ChatGPT.
Yeah, so this paper introduced a new deep learning architecture called Transformers. And simply put, it's a way to train machines, right, to do, I mean, now we know everything. Back in kind of when it was originally introduced, it was for specifically translating. And the idea was that we wanted to have something that actually can scale very well and you can train it kind of on large amounts of data and be able to get really good results. And again, deep learning have existed for a year, I mean, for decades before, but we saw kind of a reemergence of it happening around 13, especially with some of the GPU advancements. And so compute was becoming more available and scaling faster. And so this model now is the basis of what ChatGPT using, Midjourney, Claude, Gemini, all of the current technologies that are kind of advancing AI are using this kind of architecture under the hood. I mean, think of it as this is the blueprint for the car, and like every car now using the same blueprint, right? There's four wheels, there's engine, there's kind of now different companies obviously modified, and OpenAI did an amazing job scaling this and getting to amazing results with GPT-4 now. But the architecture kind of is underlying this architecture from the paper.
Yeah, the industry and environment is so much complicated. And I actually found that you went to GTC and talked about the AI issue with Mr. Jensen Huang. So, and could you share what you talked about it at GTC?
Yeah, so we had a panel where we had everyone except Nikki from the paper, all the authors coming together. And then the conversation really was about how this model came about, as well as what we see in the future, how we see this evolving, right? I think everybody's asking, is Transformers everything, or is there will be a new architecture going forward, right? And I think all of us agree that we need something new and need to continue advancing the technology space here, as well as just, you know, everybody shared kind of what they're working on right now. Every one of us have their own startup now and working on kind of different areas of the kind of AI as well as Web3 in my case space.
Do you think that blockchain and AI mark industry is on progress?
Yeah, so I mean, we see kind of obviously AI been evolving extremely quickly over the past kind of year and a half, and I'm expecting this progress just to continue, and like the amount of resources being invested is tremendous. And similarly with blockchain, we've seen kind of transformation where I remember when we started in 2018, like nothing worked, right? There was no users, nothing worked.
That's true.
And over the past, you know, 3 years, as I said, like we've seen it, you know, like every year we have a 10x improvement in like number of users and as well as an experience. And with chain abstraction now, I think kind of interestingly, the need for chain abstraction came from that we have now so much experiences in chains in the ecosystem because of the success of this and the growth, right? So now we need to figure out how to abstract it and make it easy to use. So yeah, a lot of it is like gross kind of pain and growth opportunity now that I think showcases how this space is continues to evolve.
Yeah, and I think this is this will gain more attention since, you know, there is a kind of a geopolitical turbulence in recent area, and the deepfake is also another issue in this recent era. So, could you give us any more idea on deepfaking and blockchain?
Yeah, exactly. So I think one important note is the deepfakes existed before AI. I
mean, they were just
fakes.
Like Photoshop and everything.
Yeah, or even easier. Let's say, you know, you publish an article and somebody just goes and edits the title and takes a screenshot and posts it on Twitter, right? Now everybody is angry at you even though you didn't write it. That keeps happening and like you don't need an AI tool to do that. And so the reality is people generally it's too easy because of the information distribution platforms is information is too easy to spread and people are not always verifying right what it came from and where it came from. And so I think similarly how we had a transition from HTTP to HTTPS to secure the internet, we need the same thing to happen for content now, where we go from right now a bunch of content on the internet to assigned content that you can actually have attribution and know where it came from. And this needs to happen across browsers, across social media websites, and on media kind of also signing on this. A really interesting data point here, White House recently decided to start cryptographically signing their video content because they're afraid of deepfakes. So I think, and blockchain kind of plays a fundamental role of coordinating, like if you're signing, what key you're signing with, right? What's the identity of this? Where is this registered? How do you validate it? It hasn't been republished, etc. So I think cryptography and blockchain will play a tremendous role in kind of upgrading security of the whole kind of internet for the content.
So, and you also opened a near Korea in 2022. So I wonder what kind of result did near Korea have made so far and what business they are doing now?
Yeah, so I announced it at Biddle Asia actually in 22, and then it started at full force beginning of 23. And so the focus being a combination of efforts, right? One is to support local developers and builders. They have organized hackathons, including last year Biddle Asia, as well as some other hackathons around Seoul. They're working with a number of larger brands. We have partnerships with Marble Axe and a few others, kind of bringing those, as well as kind of, you know, increasing awareness of the near blockchain, its benefits, and kind of bringing some of the developers who are building in the near ecosystem, kind of making sure they're supported and making progress.
So how do you link AI to and Web3 blockchain?
Yeah, so what Web3 really provides is a unique kind of way of managing ownership, creating incentives, and kind of coordinating people and assets. And my strong belief is that we need to build a world where people are in control of their own assets, data, and power of choice. And to enable that, Web3 is a fundamental component, and AI is the other piece. The AI is really what will be creating the kind of new experiences. It will be what will bridge the gap of right now people who cannot code, cannot interact and use computing as well as people who could. It will bring us new tools and new advancements in science kind of by using this. And so the challenge that right now we have, though, is companies who are providing the services, they are inherently have the motivation to increase revenue. And so when you actually have already have all of your addressable market, the only thing you can do, you only can grow average revenue per user, which means you need to change users' behavior to really, for them, you know, to extract more money in a way from that interaction. And so I think that's a very dangerous state going forward, especially with this kind of intelligence tools, which are becoming, you know, like they're becoming our aids, right, of our own intelligence. And so they're easier to kind of affect our own decisions. And so I think AI should be user-owned. It should be on our side. And like you should have a trust that this model is kind of following your best interests. And that's where Web3 comes in, becoming kind of an important tool, both to keep AI open source, incentivize having models that are, you know, on your side or maybe running on your device, or at least have a network of people who can provide you compute to run it, as well as data and other ways to contribute kind of to these models going forward. So a good example is these models now can, you know, read all the articles, watch all the videos, and provide direct kind of answer or summary to the user. And so the creators, right, everybody from journalists to creators of video content, are now don't have a direct way of communication with the user anymore. And so we need a new model where the content that you create is rewarded when it goes into these models. And so again, blockchain is a really powerful tool to create such kind of creator economy that really spans beyond the normal distribution platforms of you know, publications or social media.
I'm not really savvy with blockchain, so I wonder what abstract chain you mentioned.
Chain abstraction. Yeah, so chain abstraction, this idea, if we want to bring millions of users, right, you cannot expect the users to understand exactly all of the intricacies of different blockchains, of how to use them, of addresses, of private keys. And so kind of we really focused on simplifying all that, right? Again, the users that we have on Near, most of them don't fully know they're using Near blockchain, right? They're just benefiting from self-custody, from self-sovereignty. And so the same idea we want to bring to the whole Web3, it's not just Near applications, it's now Ethereum applications, Bitcoin, Solana, Cosmos, etc. All of them kind of abstracted out and really provided to the user as apps, right? An example to use, you know, you go to Netflix, you don't really like need to think if this movie is, you know, in this data center or that data center, right? You just watch a movie. Or you go to different websites, right? You don't think which, you know, cloud provider is like Amazon or Google. No, it just works. So like that's a level of experience we want to achieve. Yeah, the important part is kind of with this launch, I mean, we encourage everyone who is kind of excited about Web3 but may have been limited by kind of this current experience to really try, as we're going to see a lot more kind of easy to use applications coming online in the next months. And you know, if you haven't tried like applications like Sweatcoin, which are, you know, actually pays you for walking and like for creates a movement economy, really provide a unique experience to now with chain abstraction to transact across other chains, and you don't even need to think about it. Or the other example we have, for example, HOT, which is a Telegram wallet, which has free transaction for transacting, for paying stable coins. and that allows to have kind of a payment system, right, that is sits right directly in your instant messenger. So I think, yeah, just encourage everyone to try these applications and kind of experience how easy it is to use them and like how they remove the need for thinking about blockchain but deliver the value.
May I ask, what's your ultimate goal of near protocol, real protocol?
So the vision we have is everyone in the world should control their assets, data, and power of choice. And I mean, it's a very broad vision, right? First of all, like we want to hit all of the people, right? And so one of the kind of shorter term goals, but in 21, I outlined that we want to get to 1 billion users, which is a very ambitious. And interestingly, we've been growing 10x every year since then. Mm. So we went from 100,000 kind of active users to 1 million active users last year to 10 million beginning of this year.
Mm.
And so we're in a very kind of strong trajectory. Mm. Because of this, we also are the number one by active users in Web3. Mm. And kind of with that, you know, everybody now has a non-custodial wallet. Mm. They're able to transact. Some of the applications that switch to Near seen, you know, massive reduction in kind of transaction fees and operation costs, including from Web2. So somebody switched from Stripe to Near and saw a 100x reduction in fees for microtransactions. And so with that, you know, users are now controlling their assets. We're starting to roll out a lot more about data ownership as well. We have some projects in the ecosystem who are going to be providing like tooling for that. And then governance, including with AI, will be an important part going forward. So all of these pieces really like kind of form toward that vision of, you know, self-sovereignty. And so that's why kind of the way I outline it is like a self-sovereign operating system. It's everything that links together your individual self-sovereignty as well as community self-sovereignty, and kind of has Web3 pieces, AI pieces, and other technologies all working together.
Mm. Thank you. 네, 지금까지 일리아 폴로스키 니어 프로토콜 창업자와 인터뷰를 진행했습니다. 시청해 주셔서 감사합니다. Thank you for coming.
감사합니다.
감사합니다.